Hello, ladies and gentlemen, good evening. Welcome to Steven Stream. Stream time. Hi, baby. Got a baby kitty right over here. Oh, yeah. Steven Stream. Just gotta mute myself in the background. Deal. So we're going to play a little beginner's guide today. You know, we got another minute or so, so I'll tweet out that we're going live. Live now, starting the beginner's guide in just a few minutes. Done. Tweeted it. How's everybody doing this evening? Hey, Zikoticus. Hey, Daylon9. Good to see you around. I saw Cross Staves and Denaraxia talking a bunch in chat just before. That was lots of fun. Sorry, Cross Staves. I don't mean to make you choose between me and Burning Wheel. Cytotoxin, hello. Good evening, Mr. Ragnar. Hello, Lauren Danger. I bought an awesome coat this evening. Super stoked. I was doing some shopping at another store. Just to get some fall clothes, because it's gotten very cold very quickly here in Montreal, and I need some heavier clothes. And I was getting some pants hemmed, which is pretty cheap at the store that I bought them from. And I went downstairs, wandered around the mall, wandered my way over to Zara, and I was just like sort of looking around randomly at stuff, and then I was like, oh, this coat is pretty nice. Like, huh, this is a really nice coat. I was like, should I get it? I don't know if I should get it. Let me try it on. Let's try it on and see if it fits. So I went, I tried it on, and I was like, it looks pretty good. Looks pretty good. So I tweeted it, if you're following me on Twitter. Because I don't have Instagram on my phone, because my phone is so old, I can't do Instagram. Oh my god, someday I'll stop bitching about my phone. I tweeted it, and immediately like 30 people were like, yes, that's a good coat. So I bought it. My willpower was destroyed. The Beginner's Guide is a game. It is a game that launched yesterday. We're going to play it. It's from the creator of The Stanley Parable. And it's been described as a very unique and very interesting kind of game. So I'm very curious. Yes, now we know, Cross Days. If 30 people tweet at Steven, I cannot resist you. Oh man, my nose is still so just dealing with stuff. Denaraxia says, ah, I see it now. It makes you look both futuristic and like old Russian Cossack-like. I love it. It's awesome. Thank you, Denaraxia. I'm glad. Sorry guys. Still dealing with fallout of this terrible cold of mine. It's terrible. Cool. Someone's boyfriend was very jealous of my coat. That's awesome. Sly Tink. Glad. I'm currently not listed in the beginner's guide directory. Let me try changing the name. The beginners. Or beginner. Yeah, I don't know. When I type the beginner's guide, there's no, it doesn't actually show up. Yeah, that's very strange. I don't know why I wouldn't show up in the beginner's guide thing. Oh well, whatever. Someone else was asking, where is the Smexy jacket? It's in a bag, sitting over there. And you can see it on my Twitter. Markatron2K, hey, you're not late. I was just getting started. In fact, I think it's time to change scenes. Go over to the game. Oops, that's some game sound. That, and bring it up. Cool. Here we are. Options, quit, begin the game, options, video, display mode, overlay position, bottom right, top left, top right, bottom left. I don't know what that means. Back. Let's begin the game. I don't really know a whole lot about what this game is, so this is it's a brand new experiment. How's the game sound compared with my voice? Is everything feeling good there? Game audio is a tad loud. Let's see what I can do about that. I'll drop that. That should be a little bit quieter. Just checking, double checking. Back options, just push a bunch of things. That I'm not using audio. Talking over the sounds of the game, everything seems a little bit better. We'll give that a try, and if the game sound starts to be overpowering, just shout it in chat. I'll probably glance over every once in a while. And we'll see. That's better. Thanks, Stephanie. Cool. Please make sure audio is on. WASD and left click. I really don't know what I'm going to experience
here. Hi there. Thank you very much for playing The Beginner's Guide. My name is Davey Reedon. I wrote The Stanley Parable, and while that game tells a pretty absurd story, today I'm going to tell you about a series of events that happened between 2008 and 2011. We're going to look at the games made by a friend of mine named Coda. Now, these games mean a lot to me. I met Coda in early 2009 at a time when I was really struggling with some personal stuff, and his work pointed me in a very powerful direction. I found it to be a good reference point for the kinds of creative works that I wanted to make. So just to start you off, this is, I think, the first game he ever made. It's a level for Counter-Strike. You can walk around here, by the way. And mostly it's just Coda learning the basics of building a 3D environment.
Options, audio, closed captioning. Well, there's only two options, so full captions. Continue.
But what I like is that even though he starts from the simple aesthetic of a desert town, he then scatters these colorful abstract blobs and impossible floating crates around the level. And of course, it destroys the illusion that this actually is a desert town, and instead this level becomes a kind of calling card from its creator. It's like a reminder that this video game was constructed by a real person. And it kind of makes you wonder, what was going through his head as he was building this? This is what I like about all of Coda's games. I mean, not that they're all fascinating as games, but that they are all going to give us access to their creator. I want us to see past the games themselves. I want to get to know who this human being really is. And that's exactly what we're going to do here. So, it's 2008, Coda starts making these games, and he never releases any of them. He doesn't put them onto the internet, he just makes them and then immediately abandons them and they sit on his computer forever. And I think he really understood this image of himself as a recluse. At one point, he jokingly renamed his computer's recycling bin to Important Games Folder. So, you know, this was just how he worked. He tended to crank them out one after the other without even really pausing to try to understand what he had just made, until suddenly one day, he just stopped. In 2011, that was it. He made his last game, and then he hasn't made another one since. And that's why I've taken this opportunity to gather all of his work together, is because I find his games powerful and interesting, and I'd like this collection to reach him, to maybe encourage him to start creating again. And if the people like you who play this also happen to find his work interesting, then I'm sure it'll just send that much stronger of a message of encouragement to Coda. So thanks for joining me on this. If you have a particular interpretation that I haven't mentioned here, or if you just need to get in touch, you can email me at daveywreden@gmail.com. Okay, that's about it for introduction. Let's take a look at Coda's first proper game. As each game is loading, I'll show you the date that it was completed. This first one was made in November 2008.
Okay, good. I like this, but I do wish that I could turn on captions for y'all. Continue and see if they happen. And if they don't, I'll restart.
Warning. Whisper machine active. Ship destruction imminent.
This game is called Escape from Whisper, and it's one of the more generic games you'll see from Coda.
Yeah, we have no idea if this information we're being fed is factual or fictional.
It kind of looks like this game was abandoned mid-development. For instance, you have this gun, which you'd think would indicate that there are supposed to be monsters or enemies somewhere, but then clearly there are no enemies anywhere. You can't even reload the gun when you run out of bullets. But ultimately, we don't really know. Maybe Coda thought that actually it was complete the way that it is. And I think that we should talk about his games for what they are, rather than for what they're not.
Enemy force neutralized. Begin shooting operation.
Check it out. An exit. Go.
I love how you can see the bottom of the universe from this room.
That's fun. And you can also tell that the top of this is square too.
Apparently this space station has a labyrinth on it. Sure, I don't know. There's really no reason for it that I've ever been able to discern, so in the interest of time, I'm just gonna skip you on past it.
No, wait, what? No.
Or if you'd really like to solve the labyrinth, you're welcome to do that too.
Alright, that's funny. Good job, Stanley Parable Guy. Good job.
Okay, this is the part that's interesting. The game has this narrative about the Whisper Machine and how it has to be turned off, and then you get to the engine room.
Hey! You there, in the engine room. You could save us all. That beam is powering a Whisper Machine. We could disrupt it by introducing a great enough heat signature. If you... your body could stop the beam. It's so much to ask, but for all of our lives, would you do it? Could you give yourself?
Here we go. Good game, Coda.
Let me pause here for a second. What you just experienced, stepping into the beam and then dying, is probably what Coda had initially intended when he was developing this level. But when he first compiles and plays it, something goes wrong. There's a bug somewhere. And this is what happens instead.
Let's do it.
The beam causes you to start floating. And this is an important moment for him. Because yes, this is technically a glitch, but Coda identifies something human about it. Like how small it makes you feel in the face of this larger chaotic system. Or this floating could be the afterlife, a peaceful place, juxtaposed against all of the hysteria that you've just had to traverse. I don't even know. I have no idea what he was thinking, but what's clear is that after making this, something lodges itself in his brain. He wants to do more of these really weird and experimental designs. So he stops work on this and moves on to a stream of tiny little games that go in all sorts of directions. Let's go ahead and take a look at the first game he made after leaving this one behind.
November 2008. Okay, here we are.
Yep. In this game, you can only walk backwards.
Awesome! The past was behind her. Yeah, this is good. This is really good. Good job, Coda.
Oh, so no. It's a short and relatively minimalist experiment combining motion and narrative. It is less advanced than the previous game, but actually it seems to be more focused, more complete. Coda is trying to give it a unique voice rather than simply basing it on a pre-existing trope.
Why does the future keep changing? Past was behind her. Oh, yeah, so it's changing as you go through these spaces, which is really cool. Stops and looks, it becomes clearer. What is that? And the strength. Who confronted?
It's a short little thought, it says what it wants to say, and then it ends. Didn't need anything more than that. Which to me is why it works, because it gets out quick. Okay, next one.
Okay, it looks pretty dark. But I have light that goes with me. Oh, nope. We're now entering. I can't move side, I'm really not able to move side by side. We're now entering.
And that's it. Okay, the meaning of this game won't be clear just yet. Please be patient with me for a few more games, and I promise you'll see what makes it interesting. Oftentimes, Coda would put bizarre titles like this one at the start of his games.
Nonsense in every direction.
Oh, I wish I'd known him at the time that he was making these early games. He would really only talk to me about his work as he was making it. Once he stopped work on a game, like, that was it. It was dead to him. And I don't agree with that at all, but what are you gonna do?
This is pretty inspirational, guys. Uh-oh. Oh no, I'm slowing down.
Once you've been slowed to an absolute crawl, the door at the top of the stairs opens. So why, if Coda's not showing these games to anyone, why bother opening the door at all? Well, to show you, I'm modifying the game here so that when you press enter, it'll bring you back up to full speed so you can enter the door for yourself.
Okay. I don't trust Stanley Parable guy. Oh.
A room that's warm and nice and filled with little ideas for games. Coda would often tell me that he didn't mind if people thought of him as cold or distant. He said that he knew that he was actually a vibrant and compassionate person, but that it takes time to really see that. It can be a very slow climb to get there.
A normal game where you have to scream into a mic every 15 seconds to keep playing. Ready, set, fish. Okay. I am ready. I am set. Let's fish. Ah, big door.
Well, this is new for Coda. It's an actual puzzle. Go ahead and see if you can solve it.
Dark in here, like some gas or something on the floor. Thing. But I probably can't jump high enough to get out. Door. I open the door. Hey, check it out.
Don't forget that solution, because we're going to see this puzzle again soon. We're gonna see it a lot.
Hang on, I'm just gonna lower the game volume a little bit, because apparently my voice volume is a little bit low compared to... Okay, cool. Three dots on a wall.
So that seems to be it, right? You walk down a corridor, you solve the puzzle, you get to the end. Simple enough. All right, now I'm going to modify the game again so that when you press enter, it'll remove all of the walls from this room.
There's gonna be tons. Yeah, of course. Look at that. Holy shit, what?
How about that? There was more to it than we had any way of knowing. I actually find it funny that this game comes after the stairs game, since they essentially convey the opposite idea. So, in the stairs game, a dull exterior concealed a rich interior. And then, in this level, a dull interior hides this fantastic outer world. Either way, I think that the point is the same, is that most of the time you don't get to know what you're missing, or even that you're missing anything. That's not your role as a player. So if your role here is not to understand, then what is it? Aha! So, this, combined with the entering game from earlier, tells us that Coda believes his games are connected somehow. It could even be that the stairs game and the puzzle game are literally connected in between this and the entering game. There's a bigger picture that all of his games are meant to play a role in, some larger meaning that we won't be able to grasp until we've seen all of them. And once we have, we can step back and start to understand what exactly that bigger picture is.
Great and lovely descent. Good visuals.
Let's talk about video game development for a second.
Hey.
Every video game runs on what's called an engine, which determines what the game can and cannot do. So, in other words, the engine is a set of tools for game development.
Streetwise Fool.
To make all of these games, Coda is using an engine called Source.
Yeah.
Like all engines, Source has certain things that it does well, and it has certain things that it does poorly. One of the things that it does very well is boxy linear corridors. That's why so many of Coda's games are set in these large, flat, empty rooms, is just because he's working with what the engine does well. The tools available to the creator shape what kinds of creative work they're going to end up making. You might consider paying attention to the architecture in Coda's games, to notice how they seem to stem from an engine that's very good at producing linear, boxy corridors.
Hey, Nominal Giant. Welcome to my stream. It's a pretty chill stream tonight. Koya94 is asking, have I tried to press enter randomly? No need to follow this narrator guide's instructions. The answer is I haven't. And the reason is because I think that the game is operating on an emotional level that's not about you breaking the narrator's instructions, but instead on you following along and seeing. It's an experience that you play. Like the Stanley Parable, it was obvious you were supposed to try and break the narrator's instructions as much as possible, but this game, not like that. Oh, that looks pretty curious. Cool. I'm like 20 minutes into the game in Vo 5. Puzzle platformer. Not gonna end well. That's for sure. So, where are we gonna go? How about down there? Woo-hoo-hoo-hoo. Now what? Down there? Reminds me of segments of Dark Souls. Uh-oh. Ah, no. Ooh, neat.
This prison, funny enough, in Coda's original design, the doors stayed shut for a full hour before letting you go. If you don't mind, I think we're gonna skip that. This is something that he and I used to argue about a lot. You know, whether a game ought to actually be playable, whether it means anything if no one can get through it. And I would always defend that, you know, all this work goes into the game, why not make it playable and accessible? And so we just got into heated arguments over it, and there was one time that after one of these conversations, he went home, and a day or two later, he sent me a zip file entitled Playable Games that was full of hundreds of individual games, each of which was just an empty box that you walked around in and nothing else. believe me, I played every single one of those just to find out if there was like a gag hidden somewhere. There wasn't.
Could go down. Yeah, it looks like I can't get down this hallway. Right. Hey, down we go. Pretty cool. I'm into it. You know, this is really not that unfamiliar to me. Because there's an indie game development group in Montreal called the Mount Royal Games Society. And they make experimental games using whatever tools that they have available and that they feel comfortable with. And a lot of them end up feeling kind of like stuff that you'd see here. You know, kind of games that feel kind of half-finished or that, like, clearly don't do much more than exploring a space or just have, like, floating words in the air. Neat stuff. I really like stuff like this.
It's the puzzle again.
Hey, check it out.
With the exact same solution as the last time. There's still no clear indication of what makes this puzzle so special that Coda is going to return to it over and over. But I promise, I'll share with you my interpretation very shortly.
Yep, can still see the bottom. There you go. Source engine.
Here, Coda begins using a kind of dialogue system that he fashioned out of the engine's chat capabilities. Use the 1, 2, 3 buttons on your keyboard to respond.
There was a world stamped with whiteness. That's the world above. You've been there. Now this is important. Did you have to get through a puzzle with 2 doors and switches? I'd prefer not to tell you. After all, we've only just met. What? But you don't understand. We are trapped here. That puzzle is our only escape. We need to get through it. You think you want to get through, but trust me, you don't. Let me describe it for you. Let me tell you all about what is over there. 2. No, that isn't possibly enough. I need to actually be there. I cannot simply be told what it is. I must see it myself. I must escape this prison. There must be an ending. Hey, check it out. Yes, do you want to know how to solve it? No, we actually find the black space between the doors to be far more interesting. Have you seen it yet? 2, actually now that you mention it, I remember feeling strange as I passed through it. Don't think too hard about it. See it again soon. Hey, General Mittens.
And so we make one last descent down to the final floor of the level.
All right. Pretty cool stuff.
It's a lamppost. Okay, I can't tell you quite why, but for some reason, Coda fixates on this lamppost. It's going to appear at the end of every single one of his games from here on out. I'll tell you what I think. I think that up to this point, you know, he's been making really strange and abstract games with no clear purpose, and maybe you can only float around in that headspace for so long. Because now he wants something to hold on to. He wants a reference point. He wants the work to be leading to something. He wants a destination, which is what this lamppost is. It's a destination. We're going to see it in the work as well. His games are just going to become a lot more cohesive, a lot more fully developed, with more of a clear idea behind them. And as we go, that idea will get clearer and clearer and clearer.
I know y'all are just joking in chat when you say maybe I made these games, but actually, each game that we've seen here today is more complete than the most complete game I've made on my own. Thanks a lot. Game is connected to the internet. You can leave notes. All notes you see are left by other players. Nice room, not. Can you leave a note? Enter. Tab. I don't know.
So first off, I'm sure you can deduce this, but this game is not connected to the internet. All of the notes that you're gonna see have been written by Coda. This was actually the first game of his that I ever played. This was shortly after I met him at a weekend game jam in Sacramento, where I grew up. I saw him working on this very level, and it was just so different from anything that anyone else was doing. So right away I was like, I have to be friends with this person. In retrospect, I think I was probably a bit too pushy, trying to get his attention. I was over-enthusiastic. But he was very gracious about it and very patient with me.
No point to this.
And I cooled off eventually.
Oh man. Get that out, that's cool. Get all the notes off in the distance. Whoa, holy shit. You guys hear me? Hello. Reasonable.
Feel free to skip over any of these notes if they're not doing anything for you. Nothing extra is going to happen if you read all of them. Either way, to me they convey a sense of loneliness. I see this person who's filled with thoughts and feelings and beliefs and has no way to express them except as scattered and unheard voices in a game that wasn't meant to be played.
In a world full of notes, one man will read all of them. This
but
summer,
it's ironic, isn't it,
you will
that
believe
in playing this game and seeing how alone Coda often felt, that we get to know him better and actually kind of connect with him. And I have to be honest with you, this idea is really seductive to me. That I could just play someone's game and see the voices in their head and get to know them better and have to do less of the messy in-person socializing. I could just get to know you through your work. I think this is why I always liked Coda's games so much, is because it felt like they let me have that connection. I felt as though he was inviting me personally into his world. And then I feel less lonely too.
Awesome. I'm king of the world. Shit is this cavern. Boring. I can assure you guaranteed that there is an acorn somewhere here in this place, and the sailors are looking for it. Hey guys, just looking for someone to talk with. I refuse to believe. Butt ass butt. Yeah. I need to go to the frickin' bathroom. Recognize Me, Please. It's interesting, like, interspersed with... It's like he's got a couple different characters that he's written. Like, some of them just, like, write boobs. And some of them are like, I'm so alone. Some of them are commenting directly about the game. Some of them are commenting about the comments. Need other side. Door, why you so? Door, how open? Open sesame. Makes game. Includes door. Cannot open door. Thanks. Someday I will meet up the person who made this. I help people because of the internal good feeling I get. New room. Bilzergios, I think I did get your message. I need to go back and read it again. What's it about? It's not really about anything. These are, according to the narrator of the game, what we're playing through are all games made by a guy named Coda between 2009 and 2011. So we're sort of going through a game designer's work in chronological order. If I'm not very interactive right now, guys, it's because I'm like in the feels zone, y'all. This is serious stuff. This is real. Something real here. We don't know if Code is a real person. Take my hand, let's jump together. Abage shapes our nation. What's that painting? Good question. They don't talk about me that way. Can you imagine, like, writing all of these? It does not matter if you ever get over there. Like, regardless of whether or not Code is a real person and wrote all of these, someone had to write them. Very good game. I think this is not going anywhere. Next time I will do better. I need someone to talk to. Yeah, one of the voices is very lonely here. Don't listen to the other notes. Not safe. Today I learned you cannot fall off. You're a liar. Ethical. Stop faking it. Painting, what does it mean? Whoever made this has issues. Art. From up here, it just looks like dots. I think it's about how things look messy from up close and perfect from far away. Hey guys, how's it going? Just hanging. Help, I'm trying to speak. Who are all of you? Well done, all of you. I saw a person walking down there, now it won't come back. Devil Tower Star. It's about how this game is pretentious and you all suck. Stop pretending you are other people. We will all die someday. Spoilers, it doesn't mean anything. Cabbage shapes our nation again. Full Tower Star again. He was himself the most horrible creature you could imagine. Maybe I'll feel real someday. Well, I'm here now. Yeah, we're all here now. There must be a reason for it, though. His terrible secret, he kept it well. I beat the game! More room?
At the end of this level, we're going to see the puzzle again. And here, I'll tell you what I think the puzzle means. Each of these games represents an idea that was on Coda's mind at the time that he was making it. and the puzzle is a way of closing the door on a previous chapter of his life before moving on to the next one. In each of his games, after exploring a theme that, you know, he might find difficult, Coda can then place this puzzle that he knows has a reliable solution, he understands exactly how it works, and so it gives him a simple mechanism for moving on.
A ritual.
And because there's this dark area between the doors, a space between spaces, before you move on, you get to pause. Just for a moment, a few seconds to reflect on and let go of the events that led you here. To step back and connect the pieces together, to grasp at that elusive bigger picture.
Feels, y'all. I'm gonna move my camera over to the bottom. It's May through June 2009. Porn stars die.
Okay, this
too.
One is tough. It's gonna kinda just spin its own wheels for a few minutes. Hang with it.
Better at his skyboxes. That last one was really intense. Damn. Iska's going potty.
See, like, this is it, the whole game, and there's nothing that's particularly interesting about it. You just walk to the end of a hallway. Okay. Except, for some reason, Coda gets really fixated on this prison that has all of this modern furniture. And I don't know why, but he decides he needs to revisit this prison. He's gonna start over, use the same assets, turn it into something else. Okay, cool, here's version two.
What furniture ought to go in the center of the room? About a TV. Sound. Let's put a huge picture of a horse. Live Tesla coils in each corner, yeah. Who are you? Where exactly are you doing this from? Whoa. Cool, wow.
There's a bit more to this one, but still, it's not really communicating anything. It's kind of just weird for weirdness' sake.
Iska, hey baby.
So okay, he throws it out and starts over. This time he comes at the prison idea from a different direction.
Here.
Hello, please walk forward. Okay. This guide will enable you to escape any prison environment. Follow the instructions carefully. Take care that you remember each step. First, click on this table. Good. Go over to the photo frame and click to turn it slightly. Now turn the floor lamp in this room off, then turn it back on. Now go to the left side sofa. Move it over a little. Finally, touch the shelves. That's it. In real prison, the escape will now be open. Return to the start to be taken back to your prison. Yeah, we've definitely seen this dot pattern before. Been on the walls. Return.
And of course, now the table is gone and you can't begin the chain of events to escape. Here's a version where there are no bars, but you can't actually get to the well. And then a version where the inside of the prison is the outside, and the outside is the inside. Let me just blink you real quick through a few more of these. I mean, he really unloaded on this prison idea. There's nearly a dozen of them. Personally, I think it's awful to watch this. To see a person basically unraveling through their work. And for what? Like, at what point do you just go, maybe there are game ideas other than this prison that I could be working on? But Coda doesn't have that voice telling you to stop. That particular mechanism of defense against yourself. Without it, you just spiral. And so he keeps going and going and going and going and going, and then he hits on something. And he likes it. And that's it. He's done. He stops making prisons. This is the very last version of the prison game that he created, and the reason I think it works is that the prison is not actually in it.
Who is this? Hey, it's me. I'm you after you escaped from the prison. You're me? You were trapped in this prison too?
It's a conversation. And so this is what Coda wants, is to be able to talk to someone, to share what's on his mind, and to get some good advice from someone who knows. But the irony is that even in this scenario, you're still talking to yourself. You know, all of these games so far are Coda talking to himself.
What's it like to escape? Feels like being completely still and wildly in motion at the same time. Feel any different? Sometimes I'm scared I'll get out and then things will be exactly the same as before. I wish there was something between the two. It actually does change. I don't feel like the same person at all. Good. It's so nice to hear. Makes me feel really happy. Age just kind of does that, you know? Still me. I'm not somehow. It's hard to describe. Remember to enjoy being who you are right now. It won't last. Hmm.
I'm still me, but I'm not somehow. It's hard to describe. Wait, if you're me, then did you get a call from another version of you when you were trapped? No, I think I'm the first person to call back. How did you tell... Then can you tell me how to get out? Maybe I can come find you. What do I have to do? Get out. You need to tell me how you feel right now. What? That will free me? How does that work? It'll make sense. Okay. I feel afraid that nothing will ever change. Press number one.
I can see why he considers this a fitting conclusion to the prison games. After all of the obsession and frustration, just to be told by someone you can trust that things are going to be okay, wouldn't that be nice?
August 2009.
So what would it look like if Coda wanted to make a game about talking to someone other than himself?
Let's find out.
To me, this environment is meant to represent Coda's puzzle, with the two doors on either side and a dark transitional space between.
Licking the table. Well, my goodness, I'm glad as all heck that you showed up. Thought I might be having to clean this entire house all by myself, and right miserable that would have been. Everyone knows how lonesome hands make lousy homes.
You'll notice.
Oops. There.
The quality of the art is a step up from previous games, including this new and improved chat system, which he started using from this point on. From here on out, he begins putting much more effort into the visual polish of his work, and this particular game took 2 months to create as a result.
Don't worry about me. A place this nice, I'll be glad to stay here all night. Well, now, you might just be getting a little ahead of yourself there, no? Why don't we start cleaning and then you decide whether you could do it all night? I'll finish up in here. In the meantime, could you please clear the table? Done. Much nicer. That's the table I want to see. Now, could you please run into the bedroom and make the bed? Where's that? Well, you're in there. Why don't you straighten out the rug a bit? All the little details matter. It's been a long time since I've seen a house this messy. This line of work, you let go of those judgments pretty fast. It may not be your apartment, but something in your life needs straightening up. You think you've got nothing that needs cleaning, be careful, because that means it's everything. At any rate, my place is just to see a bit of peace brought here. Speaking of which, the pillows on this couch are a wreck. Could you come out and straighten them up? Oh dear, it looks like someone spilled a drink over by the couch. Maybe mop that up as long as you're over there. I feel compelled to share an incredibly cheesy personal insight. You okay with that? Make it especially cheesy. No. No, it was stupid. Sorry. Never mind. Hey, these dishes need to be washed. Why don't you come do that? Last I checked, the tub needed cleaning. How about you scrub it down as best as you can? No need to be perfect, we're all just human. Done. There's still books scattered on the floor of the bedroom, so would you put them back on the shelf? Done. Perfect. Now then, how about you come out and clear these dishes off the table?
After the intense set of prison games, this house cleaning level almost feels like cleansing. It's the moment after a particularly difficult or traumatic experience where you just need to let it sit and digest inside of you, and eventually cohere into something meaningful.
House cleaning is so difficult. How do we do it? Darling, let me tell you something. House is only as difficult to clean as you are. If you're finding the work hard, maybe you have a bit of housekeeping to do before you come to work. Ha, and here I go with another lecture. Of course I would. Don't you worry about all that
nonsense.
I know
that Tota really liked this game.
Now just smooth out the rug.
Of all his work, actually, this was the only one that he called me up to ask me to come over and look at it. This was during a period of a few months where he was, like, grossly happy all the time. Just walked around with a constant smile on his face.
Earlier, when I said I had that really cheesy thought, I was gonna say that it occurs to me that one's house is a lot like one's soul. Take care of it and it takes care of you. I don't know why I felt so weird about saying that. I presume that there's a bit of truth in it, no? Anyway, so, housekeeping. Let's keep doing this. Books, would you please clean up the books? Oh goodness, those pillows over on the couch are a real mess.
I'm glad he made this. I'm glad he found some peace.
You go straighten them up a bit and have the folks coming over to a messy couch. Question.
But, of course, it can't last.
You enjoy this?
The music stops, your companion is gone, it's time to leave. The door at the top of the hill is now open as well. Again, you can't stay in the dark space for too long. You just can't. You have to keep moving. It's how you stay alive. Which is the whole point of the puzzle doors, right? That sooner or later you have to pick up and move. I really thought that was the point of it.
September 2009. Items you love at members only prices. Why did you come here today? Was it to improve your life? Was it to get a better job? Was it to make your relationships more meaningful? No. You came here to become perfect. This workshop is going to teach you how to be perfect. I want your friends, the people in your life, to look at you and think, wow, this person is a better human being than I am. Right now, who do you think about that way in your own life? Who do you know who is so well developed as a person that they make you feel disgusted with yourself? Compared to whom you feel useless, selfish, ungrateful. I intend to make you into that person. Perfection is within your grasp. And the question is not how we do it, but how we do it effortlessly. This is easy. It is so easy. It is so easy.
About halfway through the game, the perspective
shifts. Being perfect is effortless. Oh, shit. On the way to work, I told an elderly person to start contributing to society.
And you play as the teacher. And suddenly, you discover that your teacher is just as bigoted and afraid as you are. Oh, and also you can move around the classroom now.
Being alone must be awful. Thank goodness all of you perceive me as being wise and intelligent. Do you understand that you won't be happy until you love me? This is for you. Ha! Just kidding! What if I'm not a good teacher? Everyone run! Run!
I fell pretty hard for this one. I feel like it's one of the most relatable experiences that you can have. to assume that some other person is perfect and totally fulfilled in every way and completely miss all of the little flaws that make them painfully human. I think about this game a lot these days.
January 2010.
This one took a lot longer than all the others for Coda to make. It was 4 months between this and the last one. That's twice as long as it took him to make any other game before this, and it's not like it's particularly complex, so I remember I found that a little strange at the time.
This is, I think down here there's a bunch of assets from the Stanley Parable, actually. Stage. Whew. All right, the performance is beginning. Places, please. In this scene, you'll be playing as me. We're at a gathering of professionals. First, you'll start out leaning against this wall. Okay. Good, stay right there. The woman across the room in this chair is a professional photographer of animals. It is your dream to photograph animals professionally. This is your one chance to learn something from her, to gain something, to succeed. Go on, say something to her. Wise, happy, focused, successful. Hello. Hello, that's it? That's not a conversation. You need to actually converse with her. Be a human being. Do it again. Here are all of my hopes and dreams. No, that's not what I said to her at all. You're completely missing the tone of the conversation. I was reserved, but I knew what I wanted. I was confident. For some reason, it was just that one moment, but I was confident. Maybe it's that you need a better feel of the setting. There were a lot of people around us. I'll give you some props to work with. These cones that bounce when you touch them will represent the people nearby. Now, talk to her again. Boink. Cool. You must have worked really hard to get where you are. You're messing it all up again. You'll freak her out if the conversation gets that personal that quickly. Do you not realize how important this was for me? I'll never get another opportunity like this again. Everything was riding on this. I want to try something. Try stepping back from the stage. No, I'm going to keep going. Oh. Okay, yes, this is working.
The game ends with
this is what it was like.
Premonition of what's going to happen next in Coda's life. The solution to social anxiety, to fears of
That's
having
perfect.
To perform
wonderful.
And having to chase success.
This is really wonderful.
The answer for Coda is to withdraw, to hide himself away, which is what leads to scenarios like the stairs that slowed you down several games ago,
You're
where it
great.
Just becomes harder and harder to access Coda's inner landscape because he keeps retreating. He just keeps backing away from possible connections to anyone other than himself. And to be honest, I didn't consider it very healthy when I first played this game. You know, it looks to me like he was trying to justify the idea of just disconnecting himself from the world. And that wasn't what I wanted for him or for his games. Because I feel like a lot of his games are inviting me to connect with this person, to bring him closer. But what can you do? After this, Coda went off and took another 5 months to make a new game.
June 2010. Mobius trip. To play this game properly, you must keep your eyes closed. Click to begin the game. Okay, my eyes are closed. I'm gonna walk forward, so I have no idea if anything's happening. Holy shit.
Help, I'm blind. What's going on? Am I going to be killed by a giant door? Oh shit! Captain, what can we do?
You should probably open your eyes if you haven't already. It's pretty much impossible to solve otherwise. And there is a solution, by the way.
There's a giant door, and then my vision went black. Please, someone talk to me. Truth. The only way to stop it is to speak something that is honest. Whoa. Okay. I'm bursting with creative energy. No, that isn't truthful. Oh? Oh, shit. Fucked up. Okay, here we go. We'll get it this time, guys. That's right, Kiska, we'll get it. I can't keep making these. Yes, that's it, that's the truth. It's draining.
Like I said, I was getting concerned. First off, he's never been this explicit in his work about exactly what he's thinking. So, where's that coming from? But then, even weirder, his work has potentially stopped being an outlet for him. Not like he's having trouble iterating on ideas, but he literally just can't think of new ideas anymore. And in person, he was being a lot more distant than usual. Like, you know how sometimes a person will just deflect anything that you say in order to keep themselves disconnected all the time? It was that kind of thing. Here was the point in my relationship with Coda where I really started to wonder if he needed my help in some way. His games are going to get more desperate from here on out. After this game, it's almost 6 months before he finishes something new.
December 2010. Hello? Cool. Hello? Is anyone there? Is that a person? How lovely. It's been a long time since I talked to anyone. What's wrong? You look lost. When I try to create, I feel empty. Oh no. What's happened? Did something change? It was a machine that kept me going. Stopped. Wait, you're looking for a machine? I think I know where it is. It isn't far. I need to see it to know why it stopped. I can take
if
you to
the last
it,
game
a
featured Coda talking explicitly
it's
about his creative frustrations,
puzzle.
This one turns it up to 11. Now,
if you
put yourself in
puzzle,
my shoes, playing this.
We'll find the
here's
machine.
A friend whose work is exhibiting signs of struggle, frustration, anxiety, depression, even, and yet still he keeps making games. He keeps throwing himself into the grinder even when he clearly doesn't have the energy for it anymore. Why? What is it for? Yeah.
Perfect. Come on, I'll show you.
Because from my perspective at the time and just what I knew of him, this was a result of how isolated he was. He was in his own little bubble, just sitting at his computer all day, not really showing these games to anyone, not releasing them onto the internet. And so he didn't have anyone outside of himself to connect with. He had no outlet to ground himself on.
Oh, wonderful. Can you tell me how to do it? First, you have to open the door. Okay, now what? Now you have to close the first door. Alright, what's next? Oh, white in here this time. Now I'll just press the switch here. Ah, that was so simple.
You can't talk yourself out of loneliness.
Can't believe I never saw
it. It doesn't work that way. You can't be the one writing both the questions and the answers. Then there's no movement. Then there's no circulation. If all of your anxieties are being channeled into your work, then if the work ever fails, you have no backup and you're just going to crash.
These are just some words on the walls. Trust me, you'll see. You have to say that your work is fun and easy. You have to say that game development is simple and joyous and that you love it 100% of the time. Okay. Making games is simple. Ah, that feels wonderful. But it wasn't true. Don't worry about it, just keep talking. Keep saying that creation is easy. Ah, it is easy. It never stops feeling easy.
Seeing this game at the time that he made it, it looked really unhealthy to me. I was watching him do this to himself, and I hated it.
Such
I hated
a simple
seeing
solution.
Him so trapped. It's like, video games are not worth this amount of suffering.
None of this is helping.
This is someone I really cared about. And I used to get so much joy out of seeing him create. For him to suddenly become angry and frustrated like this, it was the worst thing for me.
Any sacrifices made for my work are worth it 100% of the time.
I don't know. This is what I felt at the time. I don't know how else to explain it.
I will be saved by my work.
I wanted it to stop more than anything. I had never felt so rotten. I needed more than I had ever needed anything for this to stop.
We did it.
But it didn't stop. After finishing this one, Coda takes another 7 months and comes up with a new game.
In 2011. There's a guard in front of the door. Ma'am, glad to see you've arrived safely. We've captured the machine. It's waiting for you now. You can begin the interrogation whenever you like. I intend to be quick. Very good. Just be warned that someone called the press, so we might have a bit of attention on this one. Also, one more thing you should know about the machine. It calls itself Coda.
And of course, it's the machine.
Stopped. Stopped feeding us. It was only because of your creations that any of us could make it through every day. Apologize for leaving. Oh, nothing? All right then. I will apologize to the people on your behalf. My friends. It falls on me to deliver bad news. The machine refuses to admit that it deliberately hurt us. We will find a way to live without it. We do not need its games. Let us show it that we are not failures. Destroy creators or creations? It will destroy everything that the machine has created. Oh, neat! Coda, I'll make sure your work dies here. Isn't that what you're scared of? Having to live without your precious creations?
So now the work is becoming self-destructive.
Having to deal with yourself?
And I'll tell you, at the time that I first played this game, shortly after he made it, here's what I'm thinking to myself. I'm thinking that Coda is stuck in his own head, and that it's having a very negative effect on him, and that all he needs to do is just start showing his work to people, to get some actual feedback on his games. It might get him out of isolation. And so, as I'm thinking this, I realize that I could be the one to initiate it. Because it would never occur to Coda to start actively soliciting feedback, so what if I did it for him? If he could see the difference it would make to have more actual conversations with other human beings, would that bring him out of his mental spiral? Would it give him confidence in himself? Would it bring meaning back into his work? So I started showing Coda's work to people. I took this one, and the islands which you just played, the theater, the notes, the house cleaning game, and some of the prison escape game. I brought them to people that I knew and trusted. I asked their opinions. And the great part is that they really loved his games. You know, the point of it all was just to give him some external reference point, but they genuinely loved his work. There was nothing for him to be afraid of.
Down your weapon.
Can you see why I felt like this was the right thing to do? Because it's the thing that I always feel like I need, to be told that my work is good, that I am good. When someone really connects with a thing that I've made, when they see themselves purely in my work, there's nothing that feels better. And I got to give that very same feeling to my friend. I did something. I really felt like I'd done something good, like I was a good person. I felt like there was a friend who was in trouble and was unhappy and maybe didn't like themselves, and I could fix it. If I could give him this gift, maybe I could fix the problem. When they told me how much they enjoyed his games, it was the best feeling. It was the absolute best feeling. It made me feel so happy, so beautifully, beautifully happy. So anyway, Coda finishes this game, and then really he just kind of takes off for a while. So this is June of 2011, and I didn't hear anything from him for several weeks, I guess. And so out of nowhere, one day I get an email, and it's got a private link to a new game of Coda's. This one is called The Tower, And to my knowledge, it's the last game that Coda ever made. So let's take a look.
June of 2011. Hour.
And this is where I have trouble saying anything meaningful about Coda's work. Because more than anything else, the tower just feels distant. It feels like it's trying to distance itself from the world. It's a very cold game. This room actually has a maze in it. Except that all the walls of the maze are invisible. And then every time you touch one of the walls, there's this awful flashing and noise, so the experience is really miserable. The game goes beyond not being meant to be played, it actually seems to despise the player for trying to play it at all. But I do want to show you the rest of the levels, so when you're ready to continue, press enter and I'll put a bridge over the maze.
Let's go. Source engine blocks.
And to be fair, it's not like this is the first game that's needed some modification to be playable. Like the house cleaning game. You know, that one used to actually loop the cleaning chores and you just cleaned a house forever. I had to cut it off so that you could exit the house and the game would actually end. But that game had an idea that it was actually trying to communicate. What's the deeper idea behind the invisible maze? The only way past this challenge is to randomly guess the 6-digit code. Like the invisible maze, it's frustrating to me, because it's the opposite of everything else that Coda has made. It doesn't encourage thought or engagement. It doesn't ask anything of me, except a lot of my time. If I could have reached him during this time, then maybe I could have asked him, but I couldn't. I still don't really understand why this is here. I'll put the code on the ground for you here, though, so that we can move on.
Except that it's exactly like everything that Coda's ever made. Because, like, the prison game, you had to wait in prison for an hour before moving on. It seems like every game that Code has made, the narrator has had to alter in order to do the narrator's purpose, but not necessarily Code's purpose.
The switch to open this door is actually on the other side of the door. Meaning that it's literally impossible to solve from this side. So even if you somehow brute-forced your way through the first two challenges, and you got to this point, there's actually just no way to progress. And it's scary for me, the idea of Coda cutting himself off entirely, just saying, you know, that's it, that's the end of the conversation, not giving me any way to fix the problem. I feel like a failure, I guess, when I can't fix the problem. But I can open this door for you, so let me do that. Was I a failure for not understanding this game? I mean, I don't know why I would be. It's not like everything needs to have a solution, but I feel it somehow. I feel like I failed, and I don't understand why. I remember. It's June of 2011. I'm playing this for the very first time. And as I'm playing, I'm thinking to myself, I don't know this person. I have no idea who this person is. It wasn't the guy I knew. It wasn't my friend. I had come to so many conclusions from looking at all of his work up to this point, and then suddenly none of them... I had been trying to, though. That was the thing. For years, I was trying to get to know him, to understand who he actually was and what he stood for. I asked him so many times to please just tell me what his games mean to him. I asked him please to tell me what the three dots mean. And he wouldn't. I just felt so strongly that if I could have connected with him, that if I could have somehow made his work my own, that I would finally be once and for all happy. It was that I needed to see myself in someone else. I needed to be someone other than me. But he stopped and left. And it felt somehow like I had failed. Where did I screw up? I'm the reason that you stopped making games, aren't I? It's because of what I did. I poisoned it for you. I don't think I ever told you this. But when I took your work and I was showing it to people, it actually felt... it felt as though I were responsible for something important and valuable. And the people who played them, they treated me like I was important. They really listened and cared about what I had to say. Even though I was showing your work, it was... I felt good about myself. Finally, for a moment, while I had that, I liked myself. And then you stopped, and I didn't have anything left to show people. I just had to be with myself. And as soon as that happened, there was no feeling at all. Nothing. Less than nothing. What does that mean? I'm afraid that I did something really stupid because I don't like myself. That's why I'm releasing this collection of your work. is because I haven't been able to find any other way to reach you. I've tried everything. And so a part of me has hope that if I put this compilation out into the world, and if I put my name on it, that maybe enough people will play it so that it'll find its way to you, so that I can tell you that I'm sorry. I know I screwed up. If I apologize to you truly and deeply, will you start making games again? Please, I need to feel okay with myself again. And I always felt okay as long as I had your work to see myself in. I mean, is something wrong with me? Because I know that I did an awful thing, and I'm doing it again right now. Like, I'm showing people your work, but I can't stop myself from doing it. That's how badly I need to feel something again, like I'm an addict. There has to be something wrong with me. Can I apologize? What if I tell you I was wrong? Will that work? Will that fix it? I don't know. I don't think it will, but there's nothing else that I can do. Just tell me what you want. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Please. Start making games again. Please help me. Please give me some of whatever it is that makes you complete. I want whatever that wholeness is that you just summoned out of nothing and you put into your work. You were complete in some way that I never was. And I want to know how to be a good person. I want to know how not to hate myself. Please. I'm fading, and all I want is to know that I'm going to be okay.
More love, more praise, more people telling me that I'm good. Always more, more, more. It's like a disease.
Solution, solution, solution.
guess if someone had told me ahead of time that he just really enjoyed making prison games, maybe I wouldn't have thought he was so desperate. I wouldn't have told so many people that he was depressed. Maybe he just likes making prisons. Even now, the disease is telling me to stop. Don't show people what a shitty person you are. They'll hate you. If I knew that my life depended on finding something to be driven by other than validation, what would that even be? It's strange, but the thought of not being driven by external validation is unthinkable. Like, I actually cannot conceive of what that would be like. What now? I think I need to go. And I'm sorry, because I know that I said that I would be here and I would walk you through this, but I'm starting to feel like I have a lot of work to do. I have a lot that I need to make up for, and so I'm just gonna... Okay.
I'm gonna go get some water. And then we can debrief a little bit. So that was an incredibly moving game. Incredibly. No, Kiska. Heart is like pounding, guys. Pounding. That game said a lot of things. Hard to know where to start. I think that if you look at that game just as a world that you're trying to understand inside of the game, then there's more to it to think about and look at. I think that I saw a lot of people talking about whether or not Coda and the narrator were the same person. And I don't really think that matters, because there's an important message that still remains, whether they are or aren't, whether Coda's a real person or not a real person. For me, this is definitely art, for sure. It's easiest to say that just because it made me feel emotions. And it made me feel emotions about a lot of things, a lot of things. So, as a creator, as someone who makes things, I make things a lot. I make things for roleplay, and I perform on stream, and I performed in college when I studied music. After college, I was on stage a lot. And when I make games, that's a creation. As a creator, it's fascinating to look at because it shows something that's hard to remember when you create commercially. And it kind of points out the problem of art and capitalism in that when what you're creating has to be something that someone else can enjoy, the original message that maybe you wanted to create can get lost. When Coda created a game that required the player to take an hour to wait, or created a puzzle that was nearly impossible to solve, and, you know, the narrator would fix it, quote unquote, so the player could advance. That's throwing into contrast creation of art that speaks meaningfully to the soul of the creator, whatever reason, versus the need of art to meet a commercial goal and to be accessible not just to the creator, but to the person who experiences it. That's, I think it delivered that message in a really powerful way. Almost, you could say, if you were looking at it on one level, there are two characters, and one of them is a designer, and one of them is a publisher, or a producer, maybe more accurately. The designer is saying, what I'm creating here is important, has meaning. The producer is saying, and I know, or actually worse, producer in this game was saying, I don't get it. I don't understand why you did it that way. But if you do it that way, nobody else will like it. So let's change it so that other people will. And that was very harmful to the designer, Coda, versus the narrator. So that's one level. And then just the flow of the game and how you move through his creations over time, or her, but it was referred to as a him. Oh, it's fading because of mic settings. I can try to fix that a little bit. So you go through a period of sort of experimentation, and then you go through like the prison segment a number of times where it's just sort of the same thing over and over, and you're trying to figure out, you know, what's with this, or what does it mean, or how can I change it, or how can I fix it, something like that. And then the narrator brings up that this puzzle at the end of all of these levels seems to be some sort of a ritual to allow Coda to finalize the idea and then move on to a new one. There was a lot in this game that spoke to my divorce. And the past year of my life, looking at my marriage over and over, trying to figure out what happened. And it's a lot like going through those prisons. And every time they're different, it's always the same pieces. But it was also really powerful, because at the end of all of that, there's the puzzle that puts an end on it. that was a second level that the game was operating on. But it wasn't the only one, right? There was another level where we saw these two characters interacting with each other. And Coda was sharing something really personal with the narrator. And the narrator looked at it and didn't understand. And I think that we probably all have had the experience of either knowing someone and not really understanding them, even though we want to, wanting to be close to this person, but not knowing how to get them to open up, or not seeing them the way that they want to be seen, or being on the other side of that, of knowing someone and wanting to share with them, but not feeling like they actually see us. Not feeling like they really get what we're putting out. And there were elements of other relationships that I've had in there, and I think there are elements I think there are elements of that just about anybody can relate to, of that relationship where you're trying to just serve yourself through the relationship rather than serving the other person through the relationship. Yeah. Good fucking game. I've been doing a lot of work over the last year in feeling my emotions, listening to them, letting them be important to me. And that's how I can tell this game was so moving, because my body is, like, affected. My heart's pounding. I mean, you probably could tell I got a little choked up. Like, shaking just a little bit. That was a powerful, powerful game. And learning what my own emotions feel like to me has helped me learn a lot more about what other people's emotions may be like for them, and how in the past I didn't really have the tools available to me to be able to connect with someone else on an intimate level that Coda in the game seemed to need. My instinct, of course, like many people, it's an instinct that many, many people have, especially men. My instinct was always to fix it. To say, oh, you have a headache, here's a Tylenol. Or that sort of thing. Whatever it was, there's a problem, let's fix it. Then we can get back to being good or happy, or we can go on, we can do something else, anything. And what I've learned in the last year, studying emotions and working on my emotional intelligence, is that if someone is having a true emotion and they're trying to share it with you, they don't want you to fix it. They want you to see it, and they want you to understand it. So those are the things that I think this game is about. But the beautiful thing about this game is that it's about unique things to each person. Now you know many of the things that it's about to me. But I hope that each of you who watched tonight think that this game is about something to you. Yeah, Edenzio is making a good point in chat. Says, he or she says, sometimes, Stephen, what other people see as a problem, what some people see as a problem that need to be fixed, the other person doesn't even see as a problem. And I think that's really what Coda's experience in this game was. It was, here are these games, and they're not problems that you need to fix. And the fact that you're trying to fix them doesn't make them better, it just makes our relationship worse. Because it means you don't understand me, it means you don't see me, you don't appreciate what I'm trying to do intentionally. I like making prison levels. That's all I want to do. That sort of thing. Ah. See what time it is. 11:03. Well, that was a really good 2-hour stream, y'all. I think that's going to be it for tonight. Hope you all will very seriously consider getting this game and playing through it on your own. And trying to just be with yourself while you play it. Listen to the way your body is reacting when you play it. And feeling it. If you missed this, it will go up on YouTube. If you were here, hope you enjoyed it. So, thank you all very much. And I will see you all tomorrow at 3 p.m. Eastern for the next episode of The West Marches.